السلام عليكم. The fourth lecture in VA ECMO is about how to initiate VA ECMO. Starting ECMO after connecting the patient will be in five steps. First, we will initiate ECMO. Then we will go to ventricular decompression and forward flow, achieving adequate MAP or adequate mean arterial blood pressure, adjusting the sweep gas flow, adjusting the ventilatory setting. Connecting the patient to the circuit, the patient should be sedated and having neuromuscular blockade while the cannulation begins. Once the wire is in, we can give heparin bolus, 50 to 100 international unit per kg, and IV bolus. The goal to achieve ECT or activated clotting time more than 150 seconds to ensure the peak effect of heparin. After completing the cannulation, we can use wet-to-wet technique to connect cannulas to the circuit tube, ensuring no air in the circuit. And at the time, clamp is present on both venous and arterial tube. This video to show wet-to-wet technique while they are put saline into the cannula inserted in the patient, and also pouring saline into the tubing of the circuit before connecting them together to avoid presence of air inside the circuit. After connecting the circuit, we will start to initiate ECMO. So started by predicted flow, which is equal basal surface area multiplying by flow index. Then we will adjust the sweep gas, which is equal to on the startup, which it should be equal to predicted ECMO flow rate. And we should note that sweep gas is set to lower rate to avoid post hypercapnic metabolic alkalosis or avoid sudden decrease in BCO2. Then starting FiO2 from the ECMO site by 100%, adjust the temperature on heat exchange to lead the patient to be normothermic. Fifth step in starting ECMO is speed should be started by 2000 RPM. Then all clamps and cannulas are removed. Sixth step is the hemoglobin should be better to be 10 gram per deciliter, and good volume should be given. Tube should be examined so we can see the bright red is arterial and the dark blood should be venous. Speed can increase every 1 to 5 minutes as tolerated till we reach the predicted flow rate. If the ECMO inserted during CPR, chest compression will continue till the cannula be inside and there is the color difference between vein and artery. The other hint in the ECMO flow more than 3 liters per minute, so we can maintain mean arterial blood pressure more than 50 mm mercury. This flow can maintain the perfusion to cerebral and coronary vessels. If this compression can affect the flow and there is an obstruction of venous cannula, so the priority will go for ECMO flow. Waiting defibrillation. First, we need to correct the electrolyte. We can use antiarrhythmic. 5 to 10 minutes have elapsed as many times spontaneous conversion to perfusion rhythm will occur. The second part in ECMO circuit initiation to do ventricular decompression and forward flow. Establishing perfusing rhythm in VA ECMO can provide adequate perfusion during cardiac arrest. If there is no perfusion, no perfusing rhythm like ventricular fibrillation, we should revert it to prevent left ventricular distension. Decrease inotropes doses to the lowest level, or stop them. It's important to assess left ventricular function while titrated ECMO. Decrease vasopressor to achieve target mean arterial blood pressure 65 to 75, which is enough for tissue perfusion and not increasing the afterload. An important point in ventricular decompression and forward flow is using the native heart. We can adjust native heart through using ECHO and arterial line waveform. We can use that through targeting pulse pressure wave more than 10 mm mercury, measuring left ventricular ejection fraction without left ventricle distension. Forward flow can be detected by opening of the aortic valve every 3 beats. ECMO flow 4 to 5 liters per minute, which is equal to 80% from the resting cardiac output. Using of ECMO in biventricular failure or isolated left ventricular failure, it should balance it between RV decompression and LV distension. And using ECMO to drain blood from right atrium, that will lead to decrease right ventricular preload and lead to right ventricular decompression. And when you use peripheral VA ECMO, the returning of the blood into aorta will increase left ventricular afterload, lead to left ventricular extension. All of these lead to pulmonary edema. If we need more details, you can go for VA ECMO physiology lecture. But in condition where centrally cannulated ECMO is present, the heart is completely bypassed, so the pulse pressure will be less than 10 mm mercury. ECMO flow can titrate it to maintain mean arterial blood pressure 65 to 70 mm mercury with the flow nearly 5 liters per minute. In OR, all patients can receive LV venting, like decompressing left ventricle, using drainage gas in superior pulmonary artery, left atrium, or left ventricle. This is on bypass machine. In patients with isolated RV failure, decompressing RV is very important. So as ECMO flow can increase to achieve maximal right ventricular decompression, as it drains more blood from central venous system. Increased ECMO flow will not cause such LV distension, as left ventricle can withstand this increase in afterload. Right ventricle in diastolic diameter and ejection fraction can be assessed using echocardiography. How can we assess forward flow in patient with isolated RV failure? In patients with isolated RV failure, it's easy to maintain pulse pressure more than 10 mm mercury, as there is normal contractility in left ventricle. Pulsatility can be decreased if ECMO flow is high, if there is some LV dysfunction, or if RV is severely impaired to deliver blood to left ventricle. How can we improve forward flow from right ventricle? We can use inhaled pulmonary vasodilator to decrease right ventricle afterload. This can be achieved by using prostaglandins analogs or nitric oxide. Using inotropes to support right ventricle contractility, like milrinone and Dobutrix. The third point initiating ECMO is achieving adequate mean arterial blood pressure. What is the normal? It could be 65 to 75 mm mercury. The MAP should be based on volume and systemic vascular resistance. We should avoid hypervolemia, as it may cause left ventricular distension. We should avoid hypovolemia by giving crystalloid. Peripheral VA ECMO, the flow will direct it against the heart, lead to left ventricular distension. And right ventricular failure, we should do that can tolerate higher mean arterial blood pressure. Fourth part, initiating ECMO, is a change in ventilatory setting. After establishing the circuit, adjust the sweep gas, then we'll come for adjusting ventilatory setting. Choose ventilator setting depend on no pulmonary disease or presence of pulmonary disease. No pulmonary disease, so we can use the same ventilatory setting or ultra protective setting for lung disease like ARDS. Pulmonary disease, we can use ultra protective setting. Lung not required for gas exchange during ECMO, so ultra protective is needed, using low tidal volume to decrease the barotrauma, moderate PEEP to avoid atelectic trauma and prevent alveolar derecruitment. Ventilator settings, for example, volume control, we will use respiratory 10, PEEP 10 cm water and tidal volume less than 4 ml per kg ideal body weight, FiO2 40%. If we go for pressure control, we usually set it as treble 10, respiratory 10, VBIS 10, and inspiratory pressure also 10, with FiO2 40%. Set point initiating ECMO is titrating sweep gas. After initiating ECMO, we mentioned before that sweep gas at starting point should be equal to predicted ECMO flow. After that, we can check EBG, arterial blood gas, every 30 minutes to titrate the sweep gas based on arterial blood gas. So desired sweep gas equal to the current sweep gas multiplying by current VCO2 divided by desired VCO2. So at that time, we can decide how much sweep gas is needed. Lastly, and the last step to initiate ECMO is medication change. Sedation should be decreased and neuromuscular blockade should be stopped after stabilizing everything. Anticoagulation, once ECMO is stabilizing ECMO and adjusting ventilator, should be within 30 or to 60 minutes, heparin infusion should be started. VA ECMO has high rate risk for stroke. Circuit is heparin coated, so it can be held temporarily in case of hemorrhage without a risk for clot inside the circuit. Start heparin with non-polus protocol targeting PTT 60 to 80 minutes. In this video, after doing priming to the circuit, and we mentioned before, priming means that removing air from the circuit, they now started to do zeroing for the flow, for the speed, for alarm setting of the pressure. Every items do zeroing and to remove air from the circuit. At that time, they will start to increase the speed and remove the clamp to start the circuit. In the next video, we'll show how they failed to start the circuit because they didn't use appropriate speed. They started with 500, however, they should increase. We'll show it in the next video. At the end of this lecture, I should thank my colleagues Nada and Maisa for their help to take images and videos of this lecture. Besides the reference mentioned in here, also I depend on Elso Redbook.